ready? Okay, my friends, welcome. My name is Joachim Lally. I'm a Paulist priest, senior ministry. It really doesn't mean retired, but I mean it's. I'm still working.
Yeah, whatever you want.
Yeah, that's right. So let's begin with the prayer. Loving and gentle God, we recognize your presence here. We recognize that we are all one in you. Help us to realize this, to make it real with each moment of our lives. I pray that your Spirit of Truth speak through me, that myself, my limitations do not get in the way. In the name and in the power of Jesus, your Son and our brother forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen.
Okay, well, welcome to our new beginning of the school year. And this is going to be a 9-month course called Rediscovering Our Mystical and Contemplative Tradition. And we're going to have 2 months of Thomas Merton, 2 months of Julian of Norwich, 2 months of Meister Eckhart, and 2 months of Teresa of Avila. So it'll be 8 months, and then the last one we'll kind of have a summary, sort of with a mini retreat. Okay?
Okay.
So, fasten your seatbelts, you know. We're going to have a ride together, okay? So, we're just going to go this evening in some of the background of Thomas Merton. There's a lot of handouts back there that go back into his life and his dates and biography and all that, so I'm not going to go into that. You can read that on your own. But I would like to, let's see, I think I gave out, everybody got one of these, just let me look in a second here. Yeah, I just want to go a few terms. Rediscover means discover all over again. The Catholic Church, the Church of Jesus started with this contemplative tradition. And it was basically lost in the time of the Reformation, basically because the Catholic Church was trying to use all of its energies to refute those whom they consider heretics. All right, principally, you know who, right?
Who were they?
Luther.
Martin Luther.
Calvin.
Calvin, Zwingli, you know, a bunch of them, you know. And anyway, so they lost sight of the tradition of contemplation, of silence, of deep silent prayer. And became very verbal. Everything had to be defined and proven and, you know, and we got very cerebral. And therefore we lost this sense of the quiet and the mystical. Okay, so tradition, basically that comes from the Latin trado trotter, which means to pass down. It's passed down, it's handed down, it's passed on. So, I'd like to begin with a film, 67 minutes. It's a long one, it's a little over an hour, but it's a great film. I saw this myself, they showed it down in Louisville, Kentucky in June. I went down for the 100th anniversary of the birth of Thomas Merton. And there were 500 people from 20 countries and all of the United States. So it was a really blessed event. I was so happy I could be there. And they presented this film. And so it's called Soul Searching, The Journey of Thomas Merton. So can we start that? Do I start it or you start it? What?
You do it.
Okay.
Is that screen not there anymore?
Thank you.
I am on the Pacific shore, perhaps 50 miles south of Cape Mendocino. Wide open, deserted hillside, frequented only by sheep and swallows, sun and wind. No people from miles either way.
Thomas Merton's an artist.
He's a writer.
He wanted to be a famous writer.
Merton articulated with such clarity the reality of God's presence in the world.
I am as tired of talking and writing as if I had done it for centuries. Now it is time to listen at length to this Asian ocean. Over there, Asia.
He kept breaking new ground.
He was interested in issues of racism and of peace and of religious reconciliation.
And he's studying Mahatma Gandhi and the Chinese mystics and Zen Buddhism when most people had never heard of Zen or Buddhism.
My ideas are always changing, always moving around one center. And I'm always seeing that center from somewhere else. Hence, I will always be accused of inconsistency, but I will no longer be there to hear the accusation.
Merton is unclassifiable. He's a kind of a dangerous thinker in a way.
Paradoxically, I have found peace because I have always been dissatisfied. My moments of depression and despair turn out to be renewals, new beginnings. If I were once to settle down and be satisfied with the surface of life, with its divisions and its cliches, it would be time to call in the undertaker.
He had a lot of conflicts within him. He was trying to resolve all these things.
I think we have to understand that Merton is, in a sense, the lost soul of the 20th century. Looking for redemption, looking for recovery, looking for God.
Thomas Merton always wanted a home. His most famous book, The Seven-Story Mountain, tells of the beginning of his search. It takes him from desolation to discovery to fulfillment, and then on to more searching. Early in the book, Merton describes his college days at Columbia in New York City.
We would sit for hours packed in those dark rooms, shoulder to shoulder with a lot of surly strangers and their girls, while the whole place rocked and surged with storms of jazz. There was no room to dance. It was this strange business of sitting in a room full of people and drinking without much speech and letting yourself be deafened by the jazz. How often after a night like this, I missed all the trains home to Long Island and went and slept on a couch somewhere. The thing that depressed me most of all was the shame and despair that invaded my whole nature when the sun came up and all the laborers were going to work and some rational purpose before them. This humiliation and sense of my own misery and of the fruitlessness of what I had done was the nearest I could get to contrition. I was spiritually dead.
Here he was, this intellectual hedonist, kind of a good liver, a drinker, bit of a womanizer, and suddenly goes to the other extreme. That fascinates people. How did that happen? Why did it happen?
This is a man who is desperately seeking a meaning for himself. He says, I was so active at Columbia that I couldn't think. I didn't even know who I was.
Merton's frenzied activity at Columbia was spurred by the disastrous freshman year he had spent at Cambridge University in England. His grades had been mediocre, He drank to excess and lived far beyond his means. There were also rumors he had fathered a child. Merton enjoyed the aura these tales gave him, but nonetheless, he had come to Columbia wanting a new life.
The truth is, I was in the thick of a conversion. It was not the right conversion, but it was a conversion. I was becoming a communist. Being the son of an artist, I was born the sworn enemy of everything that could obviously be called bourgeois, and now I had only to dress up that aversion in economic terms and extend it to cover more ground than it had covered before, and I had my new religion, all ready for immediate use.
Frank Swift was his communist cell alias, but he says he went to one meeting, and then he didn't go to any more.
And that was the end of my days as a great revolutionary. The truth is that my inspiration to do something for the good of mankind had been pretty feeble and abstract from the start. I was still interested in doing good for only one person in the world, myself.
The fact was, he was a spoiled kid. In the height of the Depression, a pretty damn tough time for most young men, he is given an independent income by his grandfather, with no strings attached. No parental control, because both his parents are dead.
He was intellectually curious beyond belief. He got in with a group of bright young men who wanted to conquer the world, to know everything there was to know.
We know that he has almost a compulsion to write. He cannot not write.
He's reading the people at this time that are revolutionizing studies in English and American literature. People who had a very deep sense of the crisis of Western civilization, the loss of values, and who were seeking for some kind of a framework within which to live.
Merton's search for meaning led him to a book by the French Catholic philosopher Etienne Gilson. Reading as he rode to his home on Long Island, Merton was stunned as his shell of skepticism, years in the making, began to crumble. Suddenly he could look at gnawing questions in a different way, a way he had long ago dismissed as totally inadequate.
The truth is that the concept of God, which I had always entertained, and which I had accused Christians of teaching to the world, was a concept of a being who was simply impossible. A vague, jealous, hidden being, the objectification of all their own desires and strivings and subjective ideals. I discovered an entirely new concept of God. Here was a notion of God that was charged with implications which I could not even begin to appreciate.
Merton was rocked by Gilson's description of medieval philosophy. God was not a being. God was being itself, the essence of everything.
Now this opened his mind. Suddenly, the medieval theologians were as hip as any contemporary existentialist, and as profound as Heidegger's fundamental ontology, only 300 years before them. And this made him think, my God, there's an intellectual side to this too.
And Merton says, for the first time in my life, I began to realize that everything was interconnected. And that led him then to begin to read other Catholic writers.
Yeah, what happens in a conversion is difficult to say. You have this aha, eureka experience, and nothing looks the same again. I guess the closest that most people get to it is love. You know, when you are in love with someone, the whole world looks different all of a sudden.
Credo. I believe. What mountains were falling from my shoulders. What scales of dark night were peeling off my intellect to let in the inward vision of God. Credo. It was something quite new and strange, this voice that seemed to prompt me, this firm, growing interior conviction of what I needed to do. What are you waiting for? Why are you sitting here? Why do you still hesitate? You know what you ought to do. Why don't you do it?
On November 16, 1938, Thomas Merton became a Roman Catholic, being baptized near the Columbia campus at Corpus Christi Church.
This was a time when many people had lost faith in communism and were attracted to Catholicism. Some people cynically said they gave up one absolute worldview for another absolute worldview. But there was a kind of a flowering moment. People have called it the Catholic Renaissance in that precise period.
I think Merton was near a nervous breakdown in the late 30s and very early 40s. And I think that Catholicism rescued him from that. The peace he found and the optimism in Catholicism lifted his spirits.
I began to desire to dedicate my life to God. I was already dreaming of mystical union. I was convinced of the reality of the goal and confident it could be achieved.
For the next 3 years, Merton searched for just how he should live his life. His desperation grew as the world around him plunged into war.
It's only when he goes to the Abbey of Gethsemane at Easter in 1941 that he finds the place he's been looking for. He writes in his journals, "I should tear out all the pages of the journal that I've written so far and begin again."
This is the center of all vitality that is in America. This is the cause and reason why the nation is holding together. These men, hidden in the anonymity of their choir and their white cowls, are doing for their land what no army, no Congress, no president could ever do. There was one thought running around and around in my mind. To be a monk. To be a monk.
Merton's visit to Gethsemane lasted for a week. Returning home to New York after Easter, he couldn't get his experience at the monastery out of his mind.
Back in the world, I felt like a man that had come down from the rare atmosphere of a very high mountain. And how strange it was to see people walking around as if they had something important to do. How futile all their haste and anxiety seemed. How I longed to be back there now. Everything here in the world outside was insipid and slightly insane. There was only one place I knew of where there was any true order. Finally has come the time to go to the Trappists and try to get in. I cannot explain this except to say it in a lot of different ways. Time to get out of the subway and go away to the clean woods, or time to get out of the party full of smoke and pray in a clean bedroom. It is time to stop the arguments with the seven guys who argue inside my head and be completely quiet in front of the face of peace. No, honestly, it is time to stop being sick and really get well. It is time to be full of peace and silence.
Entry into a cloistered Trappist monastery was abandonment of self, shunning of the world, a kind of death to all that had gone before. He wanted to feel that his life had been fully lived. Paradoxically, for him this involved going to a place where many people thought there was no living to be done, at a Trappist monastery where you followed the rituals day after day and didn't have any contact with the world.
I think when Merton joined the Trappists that there was a heavy sense of punishment that he felt that he needed to endure. I think some of it came from his realization that he had messed his life up badly, that the sex and the alcohol and the destructiveness on other levels had reached such proportions that they gave him a sense of self-disgust.
How will I ever do this? Not by any power of my own, but by two things. These two things are prayer and penance. I say I want to give up everything for God. With His grace, perhaps my whole life will be devoted to nothing more than finding out what those words mean. I pray to you, God, with every breath, give me grace never to refuse you anything you ask, but to be absolutely lost in your will's immense obscurity. Doing not what my will wants for my own good, but giving myself to you, which is really the only possible good for myself and for all men. Not to demand that what I should do immediately show some result that I can appreciate, not to want to esteem anything that I do, or do anything because it will make me think I am something, but only to do things for love, and love alone.
In monastic life, it's not independence, but it's freedom that one is seeking. But the freedom is paradoxical, and then it's the freedom that comes from giving up your own will. And instead of seeking to affirm yourself, you seek to bear witness to a truth that transcends you, that transcends this world. And that's what makes you free. It looks to the world like the monks are walled in, but it looks to the monks like the world is walled out. That's the biggest thing to see, and if you experience it as being walled in, you'd be crazy to stay. Merton understood that very well early in his monastic life. You have to die to this secular ideal of the successful man, the self-made man, the independent person. It's one reason why Merton always spoke of monasticism as a kind of protest, as a kind of counterculture.
He was very much into that idea. How do I unmask the false self that I've created? Okay.
I don't even need to know precisely what I am doing, except that I am acting for the love of God. To act out of obedience to the rule of this community of men, who were all brought together by God's grace in order to love Him, is obviously to act for love. It is to love God and my brothers and the whole world. Because by our keeping our rule, the world is also saved.
The sheer regimentation of the life, it just never changes. It's a kind of an experiment in transformation. Can you dedicate yourself fully to God?
We don't know much about those years, but obviously Merton took to it with great gusto, loved the austerity, and loved being a Trappist. He had found a home.
The profoundest and happiest times of my life have been in and around Gethsemane, and also some of the most terrible.
In June of 1945, Thomas Merton had not been outside Gethsemane's walled enclosure since he had entered almost 4 years earlier. He was allowed to receive mail from friends and family 4 times a year. As was the Trappist custom, he was forbidden to speak except to superiors in the monastery. His writing consisted primarily of devotional poetry. In the larger world, the devastating global war was ending triumphantly for the Western Allies. Millions of soldiers were returning home, anxious to start a new life. For many, the celebrations gave way to disturbing questions about the past and the future.
Right after World War II, America didn't know where it was. It had been through a depression and a war. I would say there was a kind of a spiritual vacuum.
And then suddenly there was a God boom. People were running off to the monasteries, which often happens after major wars. If you go back through history, you'll see after these big cataclysmic wars, there's suddenly a turn to God.
When Merton entered Gethsemane in 1941, there had been roughly 80 monks living there. By the early 1950s, the number exceeded 240, with more arriving weekly. Part of the reason for this remarkable growth was the young man who had been so anxious to shut the door on the world, Thomas Merton. In 1948, this 33-year-old monk had his autobiography published. It was called The Seven-Story Mountain, and to the surprise of most everyone, it became a landmark bestseller, changing many lives dramatically, including Merton's.
Thomas Merton's autobiography has arrived at precisely the right moment. The Seven-Story Mountain is a contribution to man's knowledge of man. The most popular book of the year, a phenomenon in American publishing history.
The Seven-Story Mountain was a surprise to its publishers. There was no question that the Seven-Story Mountain had to have touched a nerve with people who were looking for something, looking for some kind of stability in a world that was already changing after the war.
He was convinced that God spoke through him and that his way of writing allowed people to hear things that seemed to be written for them.
Thomas Merton is one of those figures who has achieved a kind of mythic stature. I think you achieve a mythic stature when you somehow or other symbolize and connect with very deep needs in the human psyche. And I think that Thomas Merton did that.
Ironically, The Seven-Story Mountain was almost never written. When he initially became a monk, Merton had wrestled with the idea of giving up writing completely. Merton believed that in order to be totally open to God, he must subdue the passion that too often consumed him.
He was a compulsive writer. He had to discipline himself not to write the way alcoholics have to distance themselves from the nearest bottle.
There was this shadow, this double, this writer, who had followed me into the cloister. He is still on my track. He rides my shoulders sometimes like the old man of the sea. I cannot lose him. He still wears the name Thomas Merton. Is it the name of an enemy?
Abbot Frederick Dunn, the leader of Gethsemane in Merton's early years as a monk, told him that instead of giving up writing, he should use it as a way of growing in his spiritual life. It was the advice of a concerned spiritual director who also recognized the need for any income source the financially strapped monastery could find. Merton had happily obeyed and was soon producing a wide range of work, including poetry, biographies of saints, and pamphlets for the monastery. The income this work generated was very limited until The Seven-Story Mountain.
Merton received a 5-book contract. His publishing career had seriously taken off.
I think it can be said that by the early 50s, Merton was the best-known Catholic writer in America.
Merton became a household name for Catholics. This was a blessing for Merton as a writer, and a curse because he saw himself perhaps being made into a Catholic ghetto classic, and that's not what he wanted to be.
I think he realized after the popularity of his autobiography that he was now a product.
Gethsemane had been a life raft for him, but now he wanted to explore the water.
Exploring the water for Merton in the late 40s and early 50s meant transferring from Gethsemane, the monastery his writing had made famous and significantly more stable financially. It was also the religious community with which he had become so identified. Despite his love for Gethsemane, Merton felt he was not suited for the crowded conditions and changing life there. He now believed his spiritual path led him away from the Trappist emphasis on community to one where he could immerse himself fully in the solitary life of a hermit.
I have been making decisions. The chief of these is that I must really lead a solitary life. I've been writing my life instead of living it, and the effect is vicious.
I have people who come to me when I gave a retreat who said, I feel so sorry for him. He was so dissatisfied. He was so restless. That was his spirituality. I am always stretching forward. I'm never satisfied with the answer. This new answer I've discovered, I need to go deeper. Dissatisfaction was the fuel that kept him going, kept him searching for God. Complacency was his enemy.
Merton repeatedly brought his concerns to Abbot James Fox, the new leader of Gethsemane, and the man whose approval was necessary for any transfer. Fox became abbot in 1948 and would hold this position for the next 20 years.
James Fox and Merton often experienced tension with one another. James Fox was a business person, really, very efficient administrator. It was James Fox who put the Abbey of Gethsemane on a profitable status. Merton was certainly more a poet and artist, not interested in business at all. He liked the horses and the wagons. He didn't want to see modernization.
Abbot Fox told Merton that it was best for his spiritual well-being to stay at Gethsemane. Trying to satisfy Merton's desire for increased solitude, Fox allowed him to spend several hours a day in a tool shed just outside the walls of the monastery. Merton called the shed St. Anne's.
I am now almost completely convinced that I am only really a monk when I am alone in the old tool shed Reverend Father gave me. It is back in the woods, beyond the horse pasture. True, I have the will of a monk in the community, but I have the prayer in the silence of the woods and the tool shed. At least now solitude is something concrete. It is St. Anne's. Out here in the woods, I can think of nothing except God. High up in the late summer sky, I watch the silent flight of a vulture. And the day goes by in prayer. This solitude confirms my call to solitude. The more I'm in it, the more I love it. One day it will possess me entirely, and no man will ever see me again. God, my God, God whom I meet in darkness, with you it is always the same thing, always the same question that nobody knows how to answer. I've prayed to you in the daytime with thoughts and reasons, and in the nighttime. I've explained to you 100 times my motives for entering the monastery, and you have listened and said nothing. And I have turned away and wept with shame. Perhaps the most urgent and practical renunciation is the renunciation of all questions. because I have begun to realize that you never answer when I expect.
The seven-story mountain gives a reader the indication that once Burton got to the monastery, everything was going to be okay. He had entered paradise. And Merton knew that this wasn't paradise at all. He says in The Sign of Jonas, the guy who wrote The Seven-Story Mountain is dead, and Thomas Merton is dead many times over. What he meant was, is that he wasn't the same guy anymore, but his audience wanted him to be, and wanted him to continue to write books that would reflect the same kind of first fervor in being a monk that he no longer felt. The honeymoon was definitely over, and his serious love of the monastic life and his serious search for God really began.
By 1955, Thomas Merton was 40 years old and had been at Gethsemane for 14 years. Though he continued to yearn for a more solitary life, he was also deeply involved in his community, blending writing, teaching, and the regular schedule of worship. He was named Master of Novices, meaning he was responsible for the formation of the young monks entering the monastery fresh from the world. He brought his usual passion to the assignment.
He spoke of the spiritual life the way a lot of people that I had been acquainted with spoke about Notre Dame football. He had the same kind of enthusiasm about the life of prayer, about meeting God, about monastic life. This is it, man. You're lucky to be in a place where you can devote yourself to what really counts. This is the way to live.
Our vocation is not simply to be, but to work together with God in the creation of our own life, our identity, our destiny. We're called to actively participate in His creative freedom in our own lives and in the lives of others by choosing the truth. To put it better, we are even called to share with God the work of creating the truth of our identity.
As a teacher, he was very, very well prepared, certainly. At the same time, he had a real gift of being able to ad-lib, to be able to talk off the top of his head, and to inject a fair amount of humor.
When I entered the Trappist, you were supposed to put down as much as possible one's humanness and be almost like angels. I think he said, you know, we were created as human beings. God already created the angels, so don't try to be angels. Just be human, a human person seeking the divine. And this is going to take a long time, years. So don't take yourselves too seriously, or else you're just going to burn out.
Faith means doubt. Faith is not the suppression of doubt. It is the overcoming of doubt. And you overcome doubt by going through it. The man of faith who has never experienced doubt is not a man of faith.
One way that you would get a strong response from Merton would be if you were trying to give the impression that you either knew as much as he did or perhaps even more than he did on a particular subject. It wasn't that he was responding that way out of pride. It was just that mainly that he was responding to the pride that the person themselves was showing. He himself was fundamentally an extremely humble man. He wanted us to recognize the danger of trying to put forth some kind of a false persona or a false ego.
The way to find the real world is not merely to measure and observe what is outside us, but to discover our own inner ground. For that is where the world is, first of all, in my deepest self.
And I remember him saying that you come to the monastery and, oh, after a few months or a half a year or so, oh, this is difficult. And after a year or so, oh, this is very difficult. And after another year or so, this is impossible. So that's the way it should be. You just find out of your own volition, of your own doing, it's impossible. You got to surrender to the monastic discipline and just trust that it will work out.
He said, while it's true that monastic ascesis is geared to break the ego, He said the largest problem that he found in the people who were coming to the monastery was that they didn't have a strong enough ego in the first place, and they had to, as it were, learn something of a stronger ego precisely in order to have something worthwhile to break, to yield up to the Lord.
Humility is a virtue, not a neurosis. It sets us free to do what is really good by showing us our illusions and withdrawing our will from what was only an apparent good.
You never taught a method of prayer. Some people are surprised when they come to Gethsemane and find out, well, aren't you given instruction in meditation? No, because we live in sort of like a Montessori school, you know, you have a conditioned environment, and then out of that comes spontaneous reflection, meditation, gratitude, prayer. He never gave any instructions except, you know, quiet down, you know, it'll happen. That's the way he did it.
At the center of our being is a point of nothingness which is untouched by sin and by illusion. A point of pure truth, a point or spark which belongs entirely to God. It's like a pure diamond blazing with the invisible light of heaven. It is in everybody. I have no program for saying this. It is only given, but the gate of heaven is everywhere.
I remember once he took a bunch of us for a walk in the woods one Sunday, and we stopped and sat down, and he discovered that one monk had brought a book. And he says, why did you ever bring that book with you? Because you know, the book is all around you. You have your books back in the monastery, but you shouldn't have to bring one here.
And Merton said something new in a sense that contemplation was not limited to folks in monasteries, that everybody could become a contemplative. And Merton was criticized for this. My understanding is that priests wrote him and said, look, what are you trying to do? You are presenting a very complicated view of what it means to be a Christian and a Catholic. But Merton was retrieving a long tradition of mysticism in the Christian church. For Merton, Catholicism was this tradition of prayer, this tradition of a serious search for God in one's life, union with God.
Readers responded enthusiastically. Many wrote Merton pouring out their admiration and concerns. This input, combined with his young students, helped bring Merton back in touch with the world he had shunned years earlier. He found he could no longer turn his back on it.
Coming to the monastery has been for me exactly the right kind of withdrawal. It has given me perspective. It has taught me how to live, and now I owe everyone else in the world a share in that life. My first duty is to start for the first time to live as a member of the human race, which is no more and no less ridiculous than I am myself. And my first human act is my recognition of how much I owe everybody else.
A real conversion is evolutionary, and therefore your concept of God and church and things of that nature change. Merton later came to understand that our dogmas about God are very pale reflections, which is why I think he was attracted to Zen Buddhism, which has almost no dogma to it. And now his God is a God that demands the entire human family. And apart from that human family, Merton can have no God. Now, he wouldn't have said that in the early stages, that we need all humanity, otherwise we don't get God.
He kept breaking new ground. He's not only bringing cultures together, he's bringing the different religions together.
I would say it's not that he was restless and dissatisfied with Christianity in some way, but that he had this omnivorous intellect about all kinds of things. That was true not only in the spiritual realm, but it was true in literature, it was true in music, it was true of people, it was true of politics.
Merton's wide-ranging interests can be seen in his correspondence. Though still cloistered in the monastery, the letter-writing restrictions of his early days had been lifted for him, and he used this avenue to establish a worldwide network of friends.
He sat there at a manual typewriter, pecking away with one or two fingers, and he must have been like a mad woodpecker, sending out, 20 letters a day was not unusual.
The Thomas Merton Center at Bellarmine has 10,000 pieces of Merton's correspondence. These letters were to popes, Nobel Prize winners, poets, ordinary people who wrote him, 9-year-old kids. He wanted to converse with people. He wanted to share their problems. He wanted to know what they were. It was part of his vocation.
Anybody who says that Thomas Merton was this monk in a closed order isolated in the middle of Kentucky is out of their mind.
There's sort of different phases of Merton's life and different phases in terms of his importance. In the 60s, he became involved in social criticism. He wasn't a left wing and he wasn't really right wing. He was a contemplative culture critic, somebody writing from this sort of surprising third point of view.
It's true, political problems are not solved by love and mercy. But the world of politics is not the only world. Unless political decisions rest on the foundation of something better and higher than politics, they can never really do any good. There must be a new force, the power of love.
We've had some contemplative culture critics in the past. Probably the most famous and well-known is Thoreau, Henry David Thoreau.
Like Thoreau, Merton now had a cabin in the woods. His abbot was allowing him to use a concrete block structure as a site for meetings with visitors as well as a haven for solitude and reflection. From this new vantage point, Merton wrote that the good life being celebrated by many Americans was actually masking social ills. One fiery essay was called Letters to a White Liberal.
The Negro has come to realize that the white man is less interested in the rights of the Negro than in the white man's own spiritual and material comfort. We deplore his demonstrations. We urge him to go slow. We warn him against the consequences of violence, when at least so far, most of the organized violence has been on our side and not on his. At the same time, we secretly desire violence, and even in some cases provoke it, in the hope that the whole Negro movement for freedom can be repressed by force. It seems to me we have little genuine interest in human liberty and in the human person. What we are interested in, on the contrary, is the unlimited freedom of the corporation.
Well, Merton really did move from being a safe, pious monk writing beautiful pieces about prayer and contemplation into this dangerous public figure, this voice, this prophetic voice. And ordinary Catholics were shocked and appalled. And he was dangerous. Because if Merton was right, that meant that all of what mainstream Catholicism and Christianity at the time, then and even now, was saying was wrong. You can't be racist. You can't support war, no matter how noble the cause or how patriotic you feel. And you certainly cannot support the maintenance of weapons of mass destruction.
It's my understanding that some of Merton's books were burned in Louisville. And he knew it because of his writings. There were those who wanted Merton to stay where he was, keep writing about pious thoughts.
When I pray for peace, I pray to pacify not only the Russians and the Chinese, but above all my own nation and myself. When I pray for peace, I pray to be protected not only from the Reds, but also from the folly and blindness of my own country. When I pray for peace, I pray not only that the enemies of my own country will cease to want war, but above all that my own country will cease to do things that make war inevitable. So instead of loving what you think is peace, love other men and love God above all, and instead of hating the people you think are warmongers, hate the appetites and the disorder in your own soul, which are the causes of war. If you love peace, then hate injustice, hate tyranny, hate greed. But hate these things in yourself, not in another.
He was a rebel. And there was an order which didn't like rebels. You're not supposed to be rebellious in the Trappist. Because obedience is almost everything.
He got in trouble for writing against war and nuclear weapons. Because he was just so far ahead of his time. Nobody was doing this. And finally, the Trappist order, you know, cracked down on him and said, you can't publish this great new book he was going to write, Peace in the Post-Christian Era. Wow, what a thing to be even talking about.
Merton was effectively silenced by his religious order in the spring of 1962. A letter from the Abbot General informed him that he could no longer publish work about the Cold War or the nuclear arms race. He was told that if he must write about peace, he could do so, but not about war. Merton replied to a friend that this seemed the same as saying he could write about marriage as long as he didn't refer to sexual love. Nevertheless, Merton again honored his vow of obedience. Despite this adherence to his vows, the tensions with his immediate superior, Abbot James Fox, continued.
The understanding of obedience was that the person who was the superior was the voice of God, and whatever the superior told you to do, you were expected to do it, period. No discussion.
His voice was absolute. He wanted it that way. He didn't want any second thoughts or footnotes or nuances in his rule. And Merton chafed under that.
He thought that the most obedient monk he ever dealt with was Merton. Because for Merton to obey, he had to really work at it.
Many people wonder about Merton's vows and wonder why somebody with his talents and particularly his interest in writing would subject himself to those kinds of obligations. Merton never saw them as obligations, but saw them as antidotes to his own false self. Now, in our modern mindset, this could seem like an escape from responsibility. But he saw that if he didn't have some ordering, that he was capable of going in a million different directions. And so it came to him as somewhat of a relief to subject himself to an external set of constraints and obligations that ordered his external life so his internal life could explore its fullest reality.
Merton believed that his fullest reality could be found in solitude, living apart from the community as a full-time hermit. He continued to lobby Abbot James for the right to do so.
The life of a hermit is a rare phenomenon in the Catholic Church, but it is seen in the monastic tradition, as it is, by the way, in Buddhism, as a natural progression of someone who has been faithful to community life as a monk. And Merton's argument was that he wanted to have more time for solitude, more time for meditation, more time for writing really serious stuff. He says, you know, I've gone to the hermitage not because I hate the world. He says, I go to the hermitage to deepen my consciousness, to be more in communion with the world.
For in the woods, the whole world is naked and directly present, with no monastery to veil it.
Many feel Merton did his finest writing in the hermitage. There were essays on subjects ranging from Camus to cargo cults, experimental poetry, deeper studies of Asian spirituality, and further reflections on the Christian life. All this while maintaining the same worship schedule he had observed while part of the community. Though his time in the hermitage was fruitful and fulfilling, his overall health was poor. In the spring of 1966, at age 51, Merton went to a Louisville hospital for back surgery.
He is assigned a nurse, 24 years old. Say she's dark Irish, beautiful.
I got a very friendly and devoted student nurse. And this livened things up considerably. In fact, we were getting perhaps too friendly by the time she went off on her Easter vacation. I do feel a deep and emotional need for feminine companionship and love. And seeing that I must irrevocably live without it, ended by tearing me up more than the operation itself.
Before he leaves, he writes her a letter, telling her how much she has meant to him. When he gets back to the monastery, she writes him a letter saying she feels the same way too. It's really Romeo and Juliet. Not only is he 51 and she's 24, they can't drive, they can't get to one another.
A letter came today, and I was glad to hear from her. I have to think my way around the problem of this tenderness. Now I fear that a chain of events has started that cannot be stopped. Yesterday, she met me at the doctor's office. She kept saying she was scared. I can see why. I am too. There is a sense of awesome sexual affinity. And of course, there can be no hesitations about my position here. I have vows, and I must be faithful to them. There is no question that I am in deep. Some talk for a hermit.
Here's a man who had written endlessly about love, the love of God, the love of other people, who felt that his experience of love was limited. He had to ask himself, is my understanding of love real? Is what I have to say about love founded on anything?
A voice says in me, love. Do trust love. Do not fear it. Do not avoid it. Do not take mere half measures with it, but love. Believe in it. Without any special program. But my own suspicion says, where can it ever get you? Never mind. You will never let go of your image of yourself in order to love another. I feel that somehow my sexuality has been made real and decent again after years of rather frantic suppression. I feel less sick. I feel human. Nevertheless, as always, I end up impatient of sex, backing away from domination by it, suspicious of its tyranny. I love her, but I do not want to think of her. I want to get to work, to write, to read, to meditate, to get the heaviness of passion off my mind.
You gotta remember, this is the late 1960s when, 20,000 priests left the priesthood and went off and got married. The whole church was exploding.
Yesterday, the abbot came home. I don't know how much he knows, but I know he is mad and is waiting to give me the devil about it, which is only natural. I have to face the fact that I have been wrong and foolish in all of this.
Oh, yeah, it was a very dislocating time. And, I must say, I thought that the abbot handled that whole situation. It was very delicate and difficult, handled it well and clearly, and drew some boundaries that needed to be drawn.
I realized that no matter how much I may love her and be attached to her, there has never for a moment really been any choice. Life in the world has become for me quite inconceivable. I cannot imagine myself living it. Another session with the abbot. He lectured me again, not unkindly, but of course with the great moral superiority he now enjoys. Man has to gloat. I have offended and disturbed him many times, and now I should have the decency to let him enjoy his innocent satisfaction. However, on leaving, I said, when the baby is born, you can be its godfather. A slight shadow crossed his face, and he laughed with less enthusiasm. Was I really kidding? We are a pair of damned cats.
I said to James Fox, maybe a lot of your negative readings on Merton you may feel are justified. And he just said, no, he fell in love. Those things happen. And then he continued with his monastic life.
The discovery that in each other we find the meaning of life and the universe, that we are capable together of being a microcosm, a whole world, a summary of it all. And then to have the history of this world cut short. We spin in space like empty capsules. And yet, no. There is a certain fullness in my life now, even without her.
I know there are some who think, you know, finally the monk finds love and he can go to heaven realizing that he has found something that he had given up. Well, it's too Hollywood. As an admirer of his, I want to look directly in the eyes of the fact that he was breaking every vow that he had.
I kept being very mindful all the way through that I was reading Merton's account of this experience and of this relationship, and couldn't help wondering what the other side of the story might be like.
As the intensity of the relationship faded, Merton sought to find stability again. Even in the hermitage, stability was hard to come by in these times.
I remember these years quite well. We were having a collective nervous breakdown in this country. And if you weren't somehow infected by the craziness, you had to be deaf, dumb, and blind.
During his lifetime, my friends, who were his friends in the peace movement, called him the pastor of the peace movement. He's certainly a great teacher of peace. He was a teacher of peace for Daniel Berrigan and even for Dorothy Day of the Catholic Worker Movement and a lot of grassroots peace activists, young and old.
The role of Merton was absolutely crucial. Correspondence with Merton, visits to Merton, prayer with Merton, the wisdom of Merton. It was a long, hard road, and we needed help along the way, and he gave it. He gave it. He was very important to all of us. Thomas had this image of a monk as being someone on the margins, at the edge, he would say. I thought maybe his work and mine as well was to not to look upon ourselves as at the edge of anything. We were creating a new center.
A visitor to Gethsemane asked Merton, what's a smart fellow like you doing throwing his life away in a place like this? Merton replied simply, I am here because I believe in prayer. That is my vocation.
Just like the early monks in the desert, they would go out 10 miles into the desert from the big city, and then gradually people would find out where they were and they would go out further.
Well, if you're in seclusion, that means you cut off. But he wasn't cut off. There was a constant stream of people coming to talk to him.
So he needed a hermitage away from the hermitage.
New Mexico, California, and Alaska were among the sites considered for a new hermitage. Merton also accepted an invitation to attend a conference, Buddhist and Christian monasticism, to take place in Thailand. Abbot James Fox had never allowed him such travel, but in late 1967, Merton's longtime superior retired as abbot in order to become a hermit. His successor, Flavian Burns, was a former student of Merton's and was far more open to travel requests. In October of 1968, after 27 years cloistered in rural Kentucky, Merton was going to travel extensively.
I go with a completely open mind. I hope without special illusions. I remain a monk of Gethsemane. Whether or not I will end my days here, I don't know. And perhaps it is not so important.
Rumors began circulating that had him leaving Gethsemane permanently, or getting married, or being on a CIA hit list.
In 1968, Merton is not trying to figure out how he can become more socially active. Merton is looking for more and more solitude. He said, I need something that I don't even know yet. I need something I don't have yet, and that's what he was looking for. He wasn't going to hit the streets. He wasn't going to get married. He was going to go into deeper meditation.
Merton, by temperament, I think, was basically a risk taker. Merton knew that to learn anything is to leave a safe ground. Religion for Merton doesn't make you feel good. It doesn't make you feel secure. In fact, it plunges you into the unknown, into the darkness, into, he would say, the depth of reality.
The moment of takeoff was ecstatic. We left the ground, I with Christian mantras, and a great sense of destiny, of being at last on my true way after years of waiting, wandering, and fooling around. I'm going home, to a home where I have never been in this body.
Merton died a very sudden death. He was in Bangkok. He was at a meeting of contemplatives, both Buddhist and Christian. He touched a fan after a shower in the afternoon.
A couple of people have said that that he was actually murdered. I think that's baloney. I think either before or because of that short in the electric fan, he had a heart attack and he died.
I did ask the monks at Gethsemane, Patrick Hart, his secretary most prominently, about what they thought of his death and did this seem plausible. And he said, most of us are amazed that he didn't kill himself in the Hermitage. He was unbelievably klutzy. So he said, no, this fits in with Merton.
Of course, I was shocked, but I don't think I was overly thought it was bad news. Here's somebody that's arrived at the place where he came to seek in the first place. When it comes to the end, well, that's the beginning. That's why you're graduating. It's the big day. So if it comes sooner or later, you welcome it.
And here we are, all these decades later, still talking about Merton, and more people are reading Merton than throughout his lifetime.
I think that Thomas Merton could easily be called the greatest spiritual writer, spiritual master of the 20th century in English-speaking America.
Guy with big baggy pants again, needed to shave and laughed too much, drank too much beer, and he was just an ordinary guy.
And he was one of us looking for the answers also. Whether there's a God, whether there's a purpose beyond just our daily needs.
I find Merton not so much that he is a relic of the 60s, rather I don't know that we have caught up with him yet.
He and Dorothy Day together will be seen as the John of the Cross and the Teresa of Avila of our time. It will last his work his best work for centuries, the way Augustine's Confessions are still read.
The mundane, if we call daily life mundane, and the sacred was together for him.
The Dalai Lama said that Merton taught him what it meant to be a Christian.
He met persons of other religions easily and invited them to speak on a really deep level and was able to establish connection with them in ways that then led to real important dialogue.
He writes in his journey about his pettiness, his envy, his sexual temptations, his doubts. He wanted everyone to know that the mystical journey was profoundly human, that it wasn't exotic, it wasn't artificial.
For me, Merton's legacy is nothing. I mean, I appreciate nothing better than I ever would have in my whole life if it wasn't for Merton.
He surely was alive.
Merton is dead. The fire is gone, to quote his own poem. These are the ashes. It's over. The fire has gone somewhere else. Where has the fire gone?
Thomas Merton's Prose and Poetry on the Passion of Christ.
Now, since we're in the Passion season, and in book providence, I got a very nice book, an anthology of texts on the Passion, which are terrific. I thought it would be a very good idea to talk, to take some poems on the Passion or some literary things on the Passion. Tremendous. Very fine. And this will fit in very nicely with the season and with our monastic life and so forth, because we got to remember, you see, that we come now to this season of the year that reminds us that we're Christians and that a Christian is somebody for whom Christ is everything. And he's everything because he made us everything for himself. He died for us on the cross. And so he has become everything for us. And he should be for us everything as his Father was everything for him. And we've come here because of the...
Thomas Merton's Prose and Poetry on the Passion of...
have a number of tape recordings of his and CDs and so forth. And this is one from this Now You Know Media series. It's called Thomas Merton's Great Sermons. And this is one that he was giving on the, I think it's on the Trinity.
Christ.
Now, since we're in the Passion season, and in Book Providence, I got a very nice book, an anthology of texts on the Passion, which are terrific. I thought it would be a very good idea to talk, to take some poems on the Passion, or some literary things on the Passion, which are tremendous. Very fine. And this will fit in very nicely with the season, and with our monastic life and so forth, because we got to remember, you see, that we come now to this season of the year that reminds us that we're Christians, and that a Christian is somebody for whom Christ is everything. See? And he's everything because he made us everything for himself. He died for us on the cross. And so he has become everything for us. And he should be for us everything as his Father was everything for him. And we've come here because of the cross. See, we come here because Christ died on the cross. We've left everything. And we've got to remember this. See, that the meaning of our life, we really begin to get somewhere in our vocation. So you hear this over and over again, but you have to remember, you start to move in your vocation when you become convinced, and absolutely convinced, that there is nothing you will refuse Christ. See? And of course, this comes in stages. I mean, you get it in the first stage when you get in, when you come in. I mean, you've got to be somewhat convinced of that to get in the gate. See, if you're not convinced, you don't even make it through the gate. But as life goes on, it comes around in circles, and you go for many years not seeing these things terribly clearly. You're still working on details and so on. But it comes clear you have to face the fact that your relation with Christ must be such that you will refuse him nothing. See, but nothing.
Okay, just a sample of his voice. Anybody heard his voice before? Some of that. Okay, any kind of comments on the movie? What you thought of it? Yes, Paul?
Well, I was wondering about, he talked about obedience.
Yes.
Of course, he was in a monastic setting. What do you think he would say to lay Catholics at this time, when Catholics actually have formed opinions more to the political party rather than where their affiliation with the party is, rather than the teaching of the church? So how would he say to the Catholics the meaning of obedience when you find yourself in disagreement with the church?
Well, Thomas Merton is a great paradox. It's both, he liked order, he liked obedience and so forth, liked the schedule, but he was also a rebel. He was countercultural. And so he would not be one that would stress obedience without respect for your own opinion. Let me get this quotation here that's very strong. This is from this book, A Thomas Merton Reader, edited by Thomas MacDonald. And this is a quote from him. "I am opposed to the proposition that a religious person is one who obtains inner peace at any price, above all at the price of self-alienation. Faith demands certain renunciations, but not the renunciation of intelligence, exploration, spiritual and cultural renewal, profound social concern, and the defense of one's inner integrity." See, that's very important for you, your inner integrity, authenticity. "On the contrary, these are not ultimately possible without the kind of religious commitment implied by the concept of faith. For me, then, religion means, among other things, the refusal to surrender our personal center to the impersonal force of slogans, totalistic programs, and faceless bureaucracies. The Christian is, I believe, one who sacrifices the half-truth for the sake of the whole truth, who abandons an incomplete and imperfect concept of life for a life that is integral, unified, and structurally perfect. Yet his entrance into such life is not the end of a journey, but only the beginning. A long journey must follow an anguished and sometimes perilous exploration. Of all Christians, the monk is, or at least should be, the most professional of such explorers. His journey takes him through deserts and paradises for which no maps exist. He lives in strange areas of solitude, of emptiness, of joy, of perplexity, and of admiration. He may or may not attempt to give some explanation of the hope that is in him. So he was a free spirit, okay? He chafed at a lot of the obedience, okay? He followed it, you know, but, you know, they said he was the abbot said he was the most obedient of all the monks, mainly because that he, for him, obedience was so difficult. He was an independent spirit. He's a very intelligent man, you know. And he and Abbot James Fox, you know, just clashed for 20 years, you know. But he kept at it. He would keep going back, trying to get permission to go to this hermitage. He lobbied, if you would, you know. So he was not a passive wallflower, you know. Well, just walk all over me, you know, whatever you want, you know. Not Thomas Merton, you know. So I don't know if that responds to your question, but it's a good question. Yeah.
Does anyone know if he had any communication with any of the popes?
He did. He wrote the popes and heard from them, and when the popes asked him to write something, I forgot what it was now, but yes, he did. He did have communication with the popes, yeah. And with so many others, unbelievable. His correspondence was just, I think he wrote over 200 books, something like that. I was down at the library, the Thomas Merton Center in Louisville, Kentucky, at Bellarmine University, where we had this conference. And just showed all the books he's written, and oh my gosh, it's unbelievable. His correspondence, his poetry. I saw the typewriter he typed on, and his cowl, his monk's outfit, and his boots and everything. If you ever would get a chance, go down to Bellarmine University in Louisville, Kentucky, and you spend some time at his center, Thomas Merton Center. But there are 43 different Thomas Merton societies in the world, all over the world. So he is being read continually. And a lot of young adults are finding him very meaningful.
The after the Seven Story Mountain, that ended 1948, didn't it? Or he wrote that then?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So the rest of his life, is there another autobiography that he does for the rest of his life?
I don't think, not as autobiography, no, but just all the other books make him transparent, you know, by what he wrote, on whether social issues or peace or justice or, you know, whatever.
So you, Thomas Merton reader, that would be the best?
Well, that's just one of so many. I just picked up this. For instance, he's got some of the poems in here. Here's one. He wrote a poem for my brother reported missing in action in 1943. His brother was in the service and was reported missing in action and was, of course, killed. I'm going to give you the first paragraph of this poem. Sweet brother, if I do not sleep, my eyes are flowers for your tomb. And if I cannot eat my bread, my fast shall live like willows where you died. If in the heat I find no water for my thirst shall turn to springs for you, poor traveler. So he's just a powerful poet, and this just gives you poets. It's just, there's so many books written on Merton, you just can't begin to get started, you know. And I don't stand before you as an expert on Merton. I stand with you as a fellow traveler and a fellow seeker to understand some of the wisdom of Merton together, okay? So I'm not going to, like in the past, I've done a lot of PowerPoints on Richard Rohr and so forth. I'm just kind of convinced that information alone is not transformation. We can be experts and PhDs and everything else and all this and not be transformed. We can still be living in our ego, you know? So what I want to do in this course is to search with you, to ask you to do some homework on your own, to do some reflection and silence and silent prayer. If you really want to get the essence of the mystics, it cannot be just cerebral. You know, that's the last thing that they are. So I've got a bunch of material back there that I had Lisa kind of copy out for us. And so I want you to take them home and to do some reflecting and spend some time in silence, okay? And then come back next week with where you have grown, what has happened. If you want to keep a journal or whatever, but just bring back something to share, like a potluck, you know, everybody brings something to share, right? So you bring back some of the fruit of your reflection and your prayer. And I think this is the way that we can best grow together, rather than just have you hear all kind of facts and figures and analysis of Thomas Merton. Does that sound something like it might be something you want to be involved in? That's all, I don't know. But
yes.
Yes. Okay, yes.
He echoes Pope Francis when you talk about in the movie about the power of love.
Yes.
And the book that was written about the flowers of Pope Francis.
Yeah.
In the very last chapter, he says, if you're going to govern, you cannot govern without loving the people you govern. Great stuff.
He and all the mystics have the one kernel of truth in common, of course, which is everything is centered around love. And listening, I was making some notes on the movie as we went by. But I was listening to it, and he said something that he mentioned one thing that his time in Gethsemane was the happiest and the most terrible. You know, it's like the yin and the yang, you know, I can say for myself, I was a monk for 10 years. I was not a Trappist, but I was a Benedictine monk. And the Trappists consider themselves the reformed Benedictines, of course. They call themselves Cistercians of the strict observance. They went back to what they considered the original rule. And about silence, much more silence. We had a lot of silence, but we didn't have the strict silence that the Trappists have. And we got up at 4:30 every morning and not at 2. And we went to bed at 9, not at 7. You know, so just a couple hours difference, whatever. But we spent about the same time as they do in church, about 6 or 7 times a day in church, about 3 hours in all. And so I was there from I joined the monastery in 1958. And in fact, yesterday was my 56th anniversary of making vows as a monk, of September 8th, the birthday of the Blessed Mother, you know. And so I was there from 58 to 68, 10 years. And I after 1 year of high school, I went into college seminary, went into the novitiate, and then I had 2 more years of philosophy, and we somehow or another worked, I don't know why, but we worked 4 years of college into 3, and I was taking like 22 hours college credit and all this kind of stuff. I mean, plus 3 hours a day in church, anyway, it was a difficult time, let me tell you. So it was a challenging time, and I couldn't go home for I think 5 years, and you know, we had very limited correspondence. We couldn't watch television. We couldn't read newspapers. So. and we couldn't talk with people that would come unless I would stretch it, because I would like to take people on tours. And when I'd see people drive up, I'd be working the garden. I had one of the parks that I was in charge of. And of course, the Benedictines were known for their hospitality, right? Oh, well, this is not breaking the rule, you know. So I'd run, oh, would you like a tour of the monastery? And I'd get a chance to talk to people, you know. And of course, they were just driving by and they saw this huge structure on the high of the hill, you know. And they said, hey, Mabel, let's go up for a few minutes and look at this place, you know. And then Joachim and Lally got in touch with them, right? And 3 hours later, they're on their way. I showed them every broom closet and everything. I just wanted to be with people. I was tired of the same old monks all the time. Believe me. I was always, we had to confess our faults. We had to throw our scapulars down on the floor and kneel down and kiss the floor and come back up and confess our faults every week in Latin. First of all, it was in Latin, and then we gradually got out of that and went to English, just like the Divine Office was in Latin, and then it came to English. But I was always confessing breaking separation. You call it separation. You weren't supposed to talk. And even the seminarian monks were not supposed to talk to the brothers or to the priests unless it was for confession and stuff like that. You know. Crazy stuff, let me tell you. I'll tell you. The old song, those were the days. I thought this never. But we were good days too, you know. It's like it was both the terrible and the happy, you know. Both. Okay, go ahead.
Well, it seems like as much as he wanted to pull away from the world and his hermitageness, he was wanting to stay connected through his correspondence.
Yeah. Well, he was given special permission to write, because otherwise it was 4 times a year to your family, and that was it. And he got this. I think one of the reasons is that
financial.
He was bringing in money to the monastery.
They were doing.
They were trying.
As the movie says.
Yes. You know, they were trying to sell their little peanut brittle or whatever they were making. I know our monastery is making peanut brittle, but.
Cheese and fruitcakes.
So he was bringing in, he made them financially stable. So the abbot said, oh, you need to write, so, oh yeah, well, you've got blanket permission, you can just write anybody you want to. I'm just saying this is conjecture, you know. Conjecture of a Guilty Bystander is one of his books, you know. But anyway, anybody else? These are good questions and good comments. Yes.
I guess I was curious more about his relationship with God, because he talked a lot about his radical ideas and a lot about his opinions of what was happening in the world, but not as much about maybe his like inner relationship with what he considered God to be.
Oh my gosh, that was the strongest of all of his writings, was on his relationship with God and prayer. One of his books, there's a little suggested reading list back there. But he wrote Seeds of Contemplation, and then he wrote, New Seeds of Contemplation. Let's see if I have some quotes from here. This is some beautiful stuff. Just to give you an idea. Contemplation is the reason for our creation by God. Contemplation is the reason why we're here. Since contemplation has been planned for us by God as our true and proper element, the first taste of it strikes us at once as utterly new and yet strangely familiar. Okay? Our souls rise up from our earth like Jacob waking from his dream and exclaiming, truly God is in this place, and I knew it not. Contemplation is to be filled with an experience that transcends experience, and to enter with serene confidence into depths that leave us utterly inarticulate. Okay. This is Thomas Merton, because basically whatever we are dealing with in terms of mysticism and contemplation is we are trying to speak about the unspeakable. We really are. I mean, there's no other way to put it. We can be verbal and very articulate and all that about all these areas, But when it gets right down to it, it's the unutterable presence and relationship with God that you cannot speak about. You just experience it, you know. And of course, when we talk about mysticism, Richard Rohr defines mysticism as that which goes beyond ritualism and moralism, what you should do, should not do. And it also goes beyond the creedal, the doctrines, the faith dimensions, you know. So those are the three areas that mysticism goes beyond. The ritualism, moralism, creedal, they're all wonderful, they're good, and they're just not enough. It doesn't go far enough. You can go to 10 masses a day and not be transformed, you know. You can memorize the Nicene Creed and St. Thomas Aquinas' Summa Theologica and so forth, all of it, and still not be transformed. So transformation, this is a big issue in terms of mysticism. Transformation. It's beyond information. Important, but not enough. And it's beyond formation, which is primarily the will, the discipline of the will. This is information, is the intellect. Those are your biggies, intellect and will, Thomas Aquinas. But transformation goes beyond those to reveal your true self. This is a big, you know, thing of Thomas Merton. This is one of his greatest contributions to theology, is his whole doctrine of the true self and the false self. True self and the false self. If we don't understand those terms, we will never understand Merton. It's some of the main teachings of Richard Rohr, too. True self and false self. So, wow, there's just so much that we can cover, but I'm hoping that you will be hungry enough to do research on your own and to be reading some of Merton. There are just all kind of things on YouTube and all these kind of stuff. You can Google and find out everything you want to. It's not limited, the amount of knowledge out there. But all this information is not enough unless we can go into the belly of the whale, you know, the Jonas, you know, the transformation from death to life. That's the big paradigm, going from death to life, you know, suffering and death to new life and new resurrection. How did that one monk in the Redwoods Monastery in California put it?
Oh, graduation.
Graduation, yeah. On something else, there was another term he used. Transition or something. Anyway, he's now where he was wanting to be. He's home, you know. Death is the necessary step. We all want to go to heaven, but nobody wants to die to get there. Yes.
Not a question, but what would you say about, I think during the film, he said something about the novitiates coming in.
Yeah.
And something to the effect that they come in without an ego. And so they form an ego then when they're in the thing, and then they have to defeat that ego.
Right.
What's the correlation?
Okay, now that's a good point. Basically what he said was, all these people were saying, okay, you've got to die to your ego. Now, see, ego is misconceived. Ego is not your self-esteem. Okay? That's, we all need that. Oh, yeah. Ego, in the mystical contemplative sense, is that separate self that feels like it's independent of God. I can do it on my own, thank you. I don't really need you. I can put my nose to the grindstone, and I can get very ascetical, and I can do penance and fast and all that kind of stuff, and be holy, and I can just kind of do it on my own, thank you very much. That's the ego. Because when it does that, it wants the reward. It wants the credit. Because if it's something that's just given, wow, who could take credit for that? You know? Our ego wants to be somebody. We want to be stand out. We want to be famous and wealthy and all these kind of things. What are the three things that Word talks about are the help me out here. I can't think of what they are now, but it's this idea that we want to be famous, we want to be wealthy, and we want to be in control. Okay? Oh. And it's this giving up, this dying, this emptying, this kenosis in Greek, this giving up of your possessive. The greatest, like the Franciscans, I'm listening to this great webcast now, the Francis Factor, comparing Pope Francis and Saint Francis, that it's a powerful thing that is just now finished. I paid $50 to get the webcast, and I'm just now listening to it. But I think I've only got it till October 18th or whatever. Mm-hmm. I've sent it out to all my friends. I don't know if that's allowed or not, but I did it anyway. So anyway, basically they said that this idea of poverty, your material poverty, and having very little, is not the most important part of poverty. The most important part of poverty is the emptiness of your ego, of that part of you that wants to be praised and successful and in control. And all. That part of you, that's the part that we need to empty ourselves of.
Okay.
The poverty of St. Francis. And, if you haven't seen the movie Brother, Sun, Sister, Moon by Zeffirelli, it's very romantic, but it's very one of my favorite movies of St. Francis. But they showed a clip of it at the webcast that I'm watching for the Francis Factor. He just also finished a webcast with Mirabai Star, about unitive consciousness. If anybody wants to have some of these webcasts sent to you, give me your email addresses, and I'll see what I can do. All right? It's good stuff, huh? There's a lot of exciting things happening in the body, right? So, and I don't want to take all your time, but I know Kelly wants to go home sometime. So, asking you to look at these various quotations of Merton and trying to ingest them. You don't have to memorize them, but just start living them. Start praying them. Start, you know, letting them soak in like a soft rain so that you can gradually come to a different awareness, because the whole emphasis on this course is going to be on consciousness and awareness deepening. Deepening of consciousness and deepening of awareness. This is the challenge that so many of us are sleepwalking, okay, because we don't go into deep prayer. We're on the surface, and it's not satisfying the soul. That's why so many people are leaving churches, you know. It's not that they're bad people. They're just not being fed. They're looking for something that will nourish them, you know. And unless we go beyond ritualism and moralism and doctrinalism, we're not going to be fed. It's got to be silence and solitude and deep prayer. I really encourage you to go into some practice of contemplative practice. The one I use is centering prayer. I've been teaching this and practicing it since 1977. It's changed my life. I learned it in the Trappist Monastery in St. Joseph's in Spencer, Massachusetts. And you can find on this website right here in this building, www.CatholicInformationCenter, a long word here. Okay, you spell it, oh, center. Believe me, that's what it's there, though. Okay, .org. www.CatholicInformationCenter.org. Look into videos on demand. And I've got a number of them in there. Lally, you'll look at those. And then you'll go back in November of 2013, and you'll see my three introductory classes on centering prayer. It can change your life. It can change your life. It's transformed my life. It can change yours. I feel like a philanthropist every time I teach it, you know. Just one of the last things. I'm going to give us some more humor as we go along, right? I like this one. I used to eat a lot of natural foods until I learned that most people die of natural causes. The gardening rule, when weeding, the best way to make sure you're removing a weed and not a valuable plant is to pull on it. If it comes out of the ground easily, it's a valuable plant. Never take life seriously, nobody gets out alive anyway. There are two kinds of pedestrians, the quick and the dead. Life is sexually transmitted. Health is merely the slowest possible rate at which one can die. Whenever I feel blue, I start breathing again. If corn oil is made from corn and vegetable oil is made from vegetables, then what does baby oil come from?
Oh.
Why doesn't the glue stick to the inside of the bottle? Okay, those are just some. In our search for God, we need to not take ourselves too seriously. You know, we need to be able to laugh and to be able to see with non-gentle judgment eyes. That is the secret to the spiritual life, not judging. That's another, I don't know if that course is in that video on demand, but that's one of my favorite courses to teach, how to live without judging yourself, others, and God. So, let us pray. Strong and gentle God, your spirit is flowing through us, with us, and in us.